When the world is ruled by violence and the soul of mankind fades, the children's path shall be darkened by the shadows of the Neon Maniacs.
Let's take a look back at Neon Maniacs, a film that is massively flawed but at the same time underappreciated and has massive potential for a horror franchise via a reboot or remake. It is a 1986 American monster horror film directed by Joseph Mangine and is also known as Evil Dead Warriors. In the 1980s especially, a movie about a horde of monsters that run amok in a city, murdering innocent teens you would have thought would have been a shoo-in success with eventual sequels galore. That was not to be for Neon Maniacs, which, as it exists, is essentially an unfinished film cobbled together via what footage was shot and released to little or no fanfare, thanks to numerous production issues caused by massive financial woe. Let's take a look at those production issues. The original script, penned by Mark Patrick Carducci, who would later co-pen the Pumpkinhead screenplay, was nothing if not ambitious, calling for 27 maniacs initially. Due to a lack of financial backing, this was cut to 12. Halfway through filming, the production ran out of money and had to shut down for 3 months, which forced most of the cast playing the maniacs to quit as they now had other filming obligations. So they had to be recast, and the prosthetics covering their faces adapted to fit the new actors to finish the film. Which explains why the maniacs, who should be at the front and center of the plot in a movie named Neon Maniacs, are largely pushed to the margins for most of the film in favor of focusing on our three teen protagonists. Added to some of the actors departing, the cinematographer Oliver Wood also left the production, meaning that the director, directing only his second film, his first being 1968's Smoke and Flesh, had to stretch himself even thinner and cover both roles. After filming wrapped, he actually never directed again. Financial woes also meant that many scenes were either never filmed or had to be seriously changed from the original script, which is why the ending of the film is so abrupt, because the intended battle between the protagonists and the maniacs was just never filmed. Although the ending does fit the 80s trope of sequel bait perfectly, for obvious reasons, the sequels never happened. So it will come as no surprise when I tell you this was a literal commercial and critical non-entity on release, after sitting on the shelf for a number of years after production wrapped. The rumoured budget was a meagre $1.5 million for a film with such a large and ambitious vision. You'd have probably needed at least 10 to 15 million to have realised that. I can't find any information for the film's box office take at all, which is unsurprising as it only received a very limited release. Critical reaction was also non-existent, being the first and to date only film I've covered that hasn't received a single professional review. So I'm forced to use a quote from someone called Reed Alexander's personal blog, "Jesus fucking Christ, what a dumpster fire." He's not wrong, this movie is a narrative dumpster fire, but one with a huge amount of unrealised potential, and one that still manages to somehow be an entertaining watch despite its obvious flaws. The film has gone on, in spite of all this, to inspire a small but committed following on home video over the years, receiving a DVD release by Code Red, and a limited 3,000 run Blu-ray which is out of print and difficult to get hold of in recent years. So why exactly do I think this movie, despite spending close to 700 words telling you just how bad it is, deserves your attention? We follow Natalie, played by Leilani Sarelle, who escapes a bloody slaughter, but she cannot convince anyone that the horror of the Neon Maniacs is real. But the legions of the damned lie await in the heart of San Francisco. As night falls, they are unleashed to carve terror into the souls of the pure and innocent. Even as it exists today in its partly unfinished state, Neon Maniacs still has a lot of charm, interesting and varied monsters, and just enough gore and a sprinkling are that unexplainable quality that all truly great good bad movies possess. There is a great mix of Breakfast Club teen characters, a battle of the bands, and a multitude of 80s nostalgia to spot in the background of almost every scene. The Maniacs themselves look fantastic even now, with a huge variety in appearance and forms of killing. I've said on multiple occasions, I'll take a good practical effect over CGI any day, and this is no different. Even though nothing makes sense about them narratively, or is ever explained as to who they are, why they are, or what they want with our protagonist Natalie, as she says herself.
Yeah, but why are they after me?
I don't know.
Steve, your boyfriend doesn't know. I don't know, and I doubt anyone who has ever watched this knows. But it doesn't really matter, and in the grand scheme of things, they just exist to kill. It has some great special effects for the era and budget involved. As makeup effects artist Shannon Shea said in his book I'm Rubber, You Are Glue, about the effect used when a maniac dies, the water hit the cotton candy and it did melt into bright pink and blue rivulets. But was it successful? Who could tell? It was a low budget movie entitled Neon Maniacs for corn's sake. Did it matter? It did work. And just like the fact almost nothing about the Neon Maniacs themselves makes narrative sense, in the end, no, it doesn't matter. Because despite all the difficulties of production this movie faced, it is still pretty great and worth your time. If for nothing else, to see a man's still beating heart pulled from his chest in one of the more gorier deaths. Even if you disagree that Neon Maniacs as it exists is worth your time, let me explain why I think it is a prime candidate for a reboot or a remake. Straight off the bat, it is my contention that Hollywood shouldn't remake timeless classics. What is the point? They are known as timeless classics for a reason. The only thing you are ever going to produce is a lesser copy of the much better original. It's far better to remake flawed movies with great premises, correcting the mistakes of the original to expand on and build on, or even reinstate in many cases the original vision that held so much potential, but for whatever reason failed to live up to that. After rewatching Neon Maniacs, it's an obvious prime candidate as it has bags of unrealized potential, but obvious and fairly easy to fix flaws that would instantly elevate this into a great horror film. Firstly, the title is cool, even though it kind of makes zero sense in relation to the actual movie as shot. As Carducci told Fangoria in an interview in issue number 47, the neon part is a coined term. It's a new name for new monsters. There's also a sort of electric, almost punk energy to them. In a remake, you can go right into the backstory of the Neon Maniacs and give them some lore, flesh them out, and have them be the stars of the show. Even now, there are glimpses of scenes that were probably in the original script but never got shot due to budget restraints that do exist. Like when our three teen protagonists stand outside the Maniacs' lair and never enter, instead cutting to them already being friends, plan formulated to defeat the Maniacs. I assume originally they did enter and we actually found something out about the Maniacs' lore and saw the bond between our three teens form. In a remake, we could have that scene to explain the lore and motivations of the Maniacs, plus way more scenes of the Maniacs rampaging, which cuts to the budget robbed us of. Right now, characters appear and disappear from the film at almost random. I'm guessing due to the numerous shutdowns and rewrites and actors being available for some shots and not for others. Such as the detective leading the investigation, who appears for the first act, delegates the investigation away for the second and most of the third act, and reappears in the very last scenes of the film. Of course, in a remake, this wouldn't be a problem, as actors would be available for the entire shoot. But the main reason this is a prime candidate for a reboot is because it has such huge, unrealized potential. The Neon Maniacs, when on screen, are great. They have a wide variety of looks and ways of killing. The obvious scope for a franchise is clearly there. The opportunities are essentially endless. New maniacs every movie, new protagonists, even new locations around the world if needs be. Another dimension is teased at the end as is. That's a whole sequel right there. So that was Neon Maniacs. A movie that I think is crying out for a remake or reboot due to its initial brilliant vision and potential being ruined by a lack of finance, but is still worth a watch today because the filmmakers still swung for the bleachers with what they had at hand, even though they only probably got about halfway there. Next week is Suspiria, the Dario Argento classic, so like, comment and subscribe if you want to watch that one. The week after that is going to be Phantasm 2, a viewer's request, and the week after that is going to be Event Horizon, a movie I've never actually been able to get the whole way through because it scares me too much.